Jai Hind everyone, myself Dr. Vanna Sharma from Ajay Kumar Garg Engineering College. The subject which I am taking, subject is Engineering Physics and the code is KS101T. The topic which we are discussing, name of the topic is Relativistic Mechanics. Now under Relativistic Mechanics, we have already discussed about frame of references, where we have discussed inertial and non-inertial frames. Then we have discussed about ether frame of reference and the famous Michelson model experiment. We have discussed about that experiment, its result, and then the origin of special theory of relativity. So we have discussed about two postulates of special theory of relativity, and after that we have derived Lorentz equations, which are also known as Lorentz transformation equations. And using those equations, we have derived an expression for length contraction in our last lecture. Now today I am going to discuss about time dilation. So the topic for today's discussion is time dilation. Now first we will try to understand that what is the meaning of time dilation. As you know, in classical mechanics, or you can say in Newtonian mechanics, everything is absolute, means nothing is affected by the motion. For example, if you are having a moving object, and if the speed of that object is very, very small with respect to c, then you will apply classical mechanics, or you can say Newtonian mechanics. Then in that case, all the parameters which are associated with that moving object, all those parameters are unaffected by the motion. Whereas in case of relativistic mechanics, if you have a moving object, and if that object is moving with a speed which is comparable to c, then the parameters which are associated with that moving object, those parameters are affected by motion. So we have derived in our last lecture that length that is affected by the motion. So along the direction of motion, there will be a contraction in the length of object. So we have derived that expression using Lorentz equations. So today's topic is time dilation, means time is also affected by the motion. So we will derive that expression here. So first we will try to understand the meaning of time dilation. So in order to understand this time dilation, what we are doing here, we are taking two inertial frames. You are having this frame, fixed frame, let this frame is S frame, and there is another frame S dash, which is your moving frame, means S is at rest, whereas frame S dash is moving, right? Now these two frames, they are measuring same event, means if there are two observers sitting in these two frames, let one of the observer is sitting in frame S and let that observer is O, and the observer O dash is sitting in frame S dash, and these two observers, they are measuring the time for same event. Suppose the event that is happening in frame S dash, so even let the event is going on in this frame S dash at a position X dash. So at this particular position, an event is going on. You can understand it like this. Suppose a person with a gun is standing at position X dash in frame S dash, and that particular person is firing at time T1 dash in frame S dash. And the first fire that will take place at a particular position at a particular time, then that man is firing for the second time at another time T2 dash with respect to this frame. Now that particular event which is happening in frame S dash, that is recorded by both the observers, means if this observer O, let this observer is having a clock, give me 1 minute. Suppose the observer who is sitting in frame S, let that observer is having a clock C1, clear? This clock is with the observer O, and there is another clock C2 which is present with this observer O dash, and these two clocks are similar type of clocks. Now an event is happening in frame S dash at position X dash, and that particular event, it is recorded by both C2 as well as C1, means we are measuring the time interval between those two firing. So that time interval that is recorded with the help of C1 as well as C2. Now these two clocks, they are similar type of clocks, and their time that is matched when t was equal to t dash is equal to 0, means both the clocks, they were giving same time when t was equal to t dash, that was equal to 0, when both the clocks were at rest. Now this observer, this frame will remain in the same state, whereas s dash will start moving along this direction. And this s dash, it is moving with a constant speed, and that speed is comparable to c. So v is comparable to c. It means your clock c1, that is at rest, that will remain in the same state, but the clock c2, that particular clock, it is moving with respect to an observer sitting in frame s, and that clock is moving with a very high speed, which is comparable to c. Now the concept of time dilation, that suggests that the time interval which is measured by this clock c1 and the time interval which is measured by clock c2 for same event, those two time intervals are not equal, those time intervals are different. Means this measurement of time, this time interval, that is affected by motion. So this particular concept is known as time dilation. So I hope to some extent this is clear, that time is affected by motion. In classical mechanics, time is not affected by motion, that will remain same. But in case of relativistic mechanics, when this clock c2, that is moving with a very high speed which is comparable to c, in that case the time is affected by motion. Means c1 and c2, these two clocks, they will not give us same time. So now what is time dilation? Time dilation suggests that the time interval which is measured by this moving clock, this clock c2, that time interval will be longer as compared to the time interval measured by c1. Dilation itself means to become longer. So the time dilation concept suggests here that this clock c2, that will measure a longer time interval as compared to clock c1. So there is a difference in the time in both the frames, or in with respect to both the observers, the time intervals are different. So a stationary clock always measures a longer time interval. Now what is the meaning of stationary clock? Let me explain it first. You have two clocks, c1 and c2. This c1 is at rest, and this c2 is moving with respect to O, or with respect to S. Now the event is going on in frame S dash. Event is actually happening in frame S dash. So the frame in which the event is actually occurring, in that frame, the time which is measured in that frame, that time is known as proper time. Or you can say this particular clock, this particular clock is at rest in frame S dash. Means if observer is in frame S dash, for that observer this clock is stationary, but for an observer who is sitting in frame S, that clock is moving. So that's why there is written a stationary clock. So a stationary clock always measures a longer time interval. So this clock C2 is at rest with respect to O, whereas this clock is moving with respect to observer sitting in frame S. A stationary clock always measures a longer time interval as compared to a moving clock for an event occurring in moving frame. Or a clock in a moving frame will be seen to be running slow or dilated according to Lorentz equation. The time measured in the frame in which the clock is at rest is called proper time. So as I mentioned that the clock which is present here, the clock is in frame S dash, or this C2 clock, the time interval which is measured by C2, that is known as proper time. So first you have to understand what is the meaning of proper time. So the proper time is the time measured in that frame where the event is actually happening. So the event is happening in frame S dash. So the time interval measured in S dash, that is known as proper time. So if the first firing, that will take place at T1 dash time, it means if the first firing that is recorded by C2 at time T1 dash, and the second firing after a particular time, if the second firing is occurring at T2 dash, then the time difference between these two, that time interval is known as proper time. So what is the proper time here? That proper time is denoted by T naught, and proper time is the time interval measured by C2 or measured in frame S dash. So why I have written it as proper time T2 dash? Why T2 dash minus T1 dash is proper time? Because the event is happening in frame S dash at position X dash. Now I am taking just the opposite case. Suppose the event is happening in frame S at position X, then what will be proper time? Now the event is happening in frame S, so the time interval which is measured in frame S, that will be your proper time. So in that case, instead of T2 dash minus T1 dash, our proper time will be T2 minus T1, the time measured by clock C1. Again, I am repeating all this. According to time dilation concept, a stationary clock, this clock will measure a longer time interval as compared to the moving clock if the event is happening in frame S dash or in this moving frame. So in other words, you can say if the two observers, one is stationary and the other one is moving, if both the observers they are measuring or they are observing the same event, then the time interval which is measured by both the observers or both the clocks present in those two frames, the time interval is not same. Time is affected by the motion. So this stationary clock C1, that will measure a longer time interval as compared to clock C2. So that concept is your time dilation concept. Now we will try to derive that expression of time dilation using Lorentz equations. So in order to derive those equations, what we are doing? First, you have this proper time, that is T2 dash minus T1 dash. Now suppose this particular clock C1, according to this clock, let the first firing or the first time for the first firing with respect to C1 is T1, and the time for the second firing is T2. Then what is the time interval between these two? Time interval between these two firings, that time interval is T2 minus T1. So one clock, that clock is in frame S or the clock C1, that is measuring T2 minus T1 time interval, and the clock which is kept in S dash frame, that clock is measuring time interval T2 dash minus T1 dash. Now we have to prove here that there is a difference between T and T naught. These two times are not same, these times are different. And you have to prove that this T is greater than T naught, because T is the time measured by that stationary clock present in frame S. So you have to prove that this T is greater than T naught. So that is the concept of time dilation. So in order to prove it, we are taking the help of time transformation or Lorentz equations. From there you will use time transformation equations. So if you have T2 dash time in frame S dash and the event is happening at position X dash, then according to Lorentz equations, you can write T2 as T2 dash plus this. I am writing with the help of Lorentz equations. So just mention those Lorentz, refer to your last derivation of Lorentz equations here. T2 dash plus Vx dash upon C square upon root 1 minus V square upon C square. This is the time measured by clock C1 in terms of T2 dash. Similarly, what will be your T1? According to time transformation, T1 in terms of T1 dash will be T1 dash plus Vx dash upon C square upon root 1 minus V square upon C square. So you have written T2 in terms of T2 dash, you have written the value of T1 in terms of T1 dash. Now just substitute the value of this T2 and T1 in this equation number 2. So when you will substitute this T2 and T1, you are getting T2 dash plus Vx dash upon C square upon this minus T1, that will be equal to this. Now if you will take the LCM, that will be root 1 minus V square upon C square, and in numerator you are getting T2 dash minus T1 dash plus Vx dash upon C square minus Vx dash upon C square. It means these two terms will get cancelled and you are going to get only T2 dash minus T1 dash upon root 1 minus V square upon C square here. And you know what is the value of this? This is your t naught from equation number 1. That is your proper time. So finally, what expression you are getting? You are getting t as t naught upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. What is t naught? T naught is the time measured by observer sitting in frame s dash, and t, this time is the time measured by the observer sitting in frame s. And according to this equation, you can see here, this particular factor, this factor, when v is comparable to c, this particular factor will always give you some finite value which is less than 1. So this t is always greater than t naught. So from here you can conclude that when v is comparable to c, when this is the case, when v is comparable to c, then t is always greater than t naught. It means the time interval which is measured by a clock c1, that is greater than the time interval measured by the clock c2. It means the time that is affected by motion, time is not absolute term here, that time interval is affected by the motion of that particular clock c2, right? So t is greater than t naught upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. And if this v is very very small with respect to c, if you will take this case, if v is very very small with respect to c, then this factor is having very small value with respect to 1. So the overall this factor will give you 1. So t will be equal to t naught. So if v is very small with respect to c, and you know this is the case of classical mechanics. In classical mechanics, the speed of object is very very small with respect to c. So when object is traveling with a very low speed with respect to speed of light, then the time is not affected by motion. Means that is the result of classical mechanics. Or in other words, you can say that all the results of relativistic mechanics will finally approach to classical mechanics if you are considering this case, v is very very small with respect to c. I hope this is clear. So what we have discussed here, let me repeat it. According to the concept of time dilation, time is affected by motion, and a stationary clock that will measure always a longer time interval as compared to this moving clock if the event is occurring in frame, in moving frame. So the time which is measured by this frame s, that is your t time, and the time interval which is measured by the frame s dash, that is your t naught. So t is greater than t naught. And what is t naught? T naught is the proper time, and the proper time is the time measured in that frame where the event is occurring. So the event is actually occurring in frame s dash, so, and that is occurring at position x dash. So at this position, when c2 will measure a time interval for a particular event, that time interval is your t2 dash minus t1 dash. And the time interval for the same event which is recorded by c1, that time interval is your t, equation number 2. Now you have to correlate t and t naught. So you are going to use Lorentz equations, because those equations are applicable in relativistic mechanics. So when you will apply those Lorentz equations for time, then you have t2 and t1 in terms of t2 dash and t1 dash respectively. Substitute those values and you are getting this expression, t is equal to t naught upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. From here you can conclude that t is always greater than t naught when v is comparable to c. So whenever an object is traveling with a very high speed comparable to c, then you can always say t is greater than t naught. And when v is very very small with respect to c, then the conclusion is t is always t naught. Means that is the case of classical mechanics, right? So that is your time transformation. So I hope both the concepts of one of length contraction and the other one, that is of time dilation, is clear, right? So now the concept which is related to this time dilation, that concept is that time dilation is a real effect. Now you know, according to Lorentz equations, you have proved that time is affected by motion. Time interval which is measured by a stationary clock and the time interval which is measured by a moving clock, those time intervals are not equal, those time intervals are different. Now we have to prove here that time dilation is a real effect. Means even in real world, we can observe this phenomena of time dilation. So we can prove it with the help of mu mesons. We are having these particles, mu mesons. Actually, these particles, time dilation concept has been experimentally verified by an example of cosmic ray particles called mesons, right? Mu mesons, they are created at high altitude in the Earth atmosphere, that is approximately 10 kilometer, by fast cosmic ray photons, and are projected towards the Earth's surface with a very high speed of 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. So let me explain it. We are having these mu mesons, these particles, which are actually created in our atmosphere approximately at a distance of 10 kilometers from the surface of Earth. So if I'm saying this is the surface of Earth, then approximately at a distance of 10 kilometers from here, we are having these mu mesons, these particles present in our atmosphere. These particles are actually created at this particular position in our atmosphere, right? Now these particles, they are heading towards the Earth, they are moving towards Earth, and they are traveling with a very high speed. And the speed with which they are traveling, that speed is 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. So you can say their speed is comparable to speed of light. So you have these mu mesons, which are created in our atmosphere approximately at a 10 kilometers from the surface of Earth, and they are traveling with a very high speed, that is 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. Now these mu mesons, they are highly unstable particles. Unstable means that they can remain in that particular state, means they can remain as mu mesons only for 2 microseconds. This is the lifetime of those mu mesons. After a lifetime of 2 microseconds, they will decay and they will convert into electron and positron, right? Means their identity of mu meson, that will remain only for 2 microseconds. After that time of 2 microseconds, they will convert into electron and positrons, right? Now these mu mesons, which are actually created at a distance of 10 kilometers from the surface of Earth, they are traveling with 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. You know the speed of those mu mesons, and you also know that what is the lifetime of those particles, that is only 2 microseconds. So if you know the speed with which mu mesons are traveling, and if you are also aware that what is the lifetime of those mu mesons, then you can calculate the distance which these particles can travel in their lifetime. So if you want to calculate that, then that distance traveled by the particles, mu mesons actually, in their lifetime, that will be equal to their speed into time, their lifetime. So since they are traveling with this speed and they have a lifetime of 2 microseconds, so in their lifetime, they can travel a distance of approximately 600 meters, right? But these particles, they are also present at the surface of Earth. Since they are created at a distance of 10 kilometers from the surface of Earth, so if they are also present at the surface of Earth, it means they have to travel a distance of 10 kilometers. If they can travel a distance of 10 kilometers, only then you can justify their existence at the surface of Earth. But according to this expression, in their lifetime, these mu mesons, they can travel only a distance of approximately 600 meters. Then how you will justify their presence at the surface of Earth? So in order to justify the presence of those mu mesons at the surface of Earth, you have concept of time dilation. Why you can apply concept of time dilation here? The reason is very much clear here. Since the speed of these particles, that is comparable to c. So whenever you have a particle which is traveling with a very high speed, which is comparable to c, you can apply the concept of time dilation there. For a stationary observer, the time interval, that will be different. That instead of 2 microseconds, the time interval will be given by this relationship, that t naught upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. So if you will apply this concept, only then you can justify the presence of those mu mesons at the surface of Earth. So these mu mesons, the question arises that mu mesons travel a distance of 10 km to reach the surface of Earth. This is possible only by time dilation. So how this is possible? You will apply this concept of time dilation here. T naught, that is your 2 microseconds, root 1 minus v square upon c square. This is the speed of those mu mesons. See, you know what is the speed of light. If you will solve it, then the time that will become longer. That time interval, average lifetime, that was equal to 2 microseconds. But when they are traveling with a high speed, that is 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second, their lifetime will become longer, and that dilated time is 3.17 into 10 raised to power minus 5 seconds. So now in this time, in this dilated time, how much distance these particles can travel, you can find the value of that. So that distance will be equal to their dilated time because of time dilation into their speed, that is equal to this is time and this is speed. So if you will calculate it, then this distance traveled is approximately 10 kilometers. It means this example of mu mesons, that is the justification of this fact that time dilation is a real effect. That time dilation is not a mathematical concept. Time, you can see this time dilation effect in real life, but you can see only if a particle is traveling with a very high speed, which is comparable to c, right? So what we have seen here, we have seen that there are mu mesons which are present in our atmosphere. Actually, these mu mesons, they are created in our atmosphere at a distance of approximately 10 kilometers from the surface of Earth, right? These mu mesons are created over this particular distance. Now, these mu mesons, they are highly unstable particles. They can remain in that state only for 2 microseconds, and they are traveling with a very high speed, which is 2.994 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. Now, in this lifetime, with this much speed, they can travel only 600 meters distance. But you know that these mu mesons, they are also present at the surface of Earth. It means they are traveling this distance of 10 kilometers only, then they can be present at the surface of Earth. So, how you will justify their presence at the surface of Earth? So, that can be justified if you will consider the concept of time dilation. And according to that concept, because of very high speed of these mu mesons, their time will become longer. Their lifetime is 3.17 into 10 raised to power minus 5 seconds. And in this dilated time, because of this time dilation effect, they can travel a longer distance. And the distance which can be traveled in this lifetime with this much speed, that is approximately 10 kilometers. So, actually this example of mu mesons, that is a justification that time dilation is a real effect, right? So, what we have discussed? We have discussed here that when an object is traveling with a very high speed, which is comparable to c, then the length of object will get contracted along direction of motion. This is according to your concept of time dilation, right? So, this is according to length contraction. So, according to length contraction, you have L equal to L naught root 1 minus V square upon C square. This was the concept of length contraction. L is always less than L naught, right? And this is the case when V is comparable to C. And the second one is time dilation, that t is equal to t naught upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. So, you had these two important conclusions, one for length and one for time. And in both the cases, these concepts are applicable when v is comparable to c. When v is comparable to c, l is always less than l naught. And when v is comparable to c, t is always greater than t naught. So, you have these two important conclusions here, L is always less than L naught and T is always greater than T naught if you have V comparable to C. And in both the cases, if V is very, very small with respect to C, if you will take this, then L is always L naught. and t is always t naught. It means length, time, these parameters are not affected by motion if the object is traveling with a very low speed. That is, low means v is very, very small with respect to c. We are comparing with speed of light. Clear? So it means you are finally reaching at classical mechanics when you are applying this case, v is very, very small with respect to c. I hope now this is clear. So we have solved few examples of few numericals of length contraction in our previous lecture. Now in our next lecture, we will solve numericals based upon time dilation. So that's it for today. Thank you so much.